Yes, good evening everybody, I'm Mr. Dacostas. About the paper that we have mentioned, we have made a presentation of our effort in two conferences. The first was in March, I think, in RISC 2014 conference in New Forest, United Kingdom. And the second was for during the second DCS conference in Istanbul. So these two papers contain much of the material we are going to present you. We knew that it is it was going to be a hot break evening after lunch, so hopefully you will find our presentation not heavy. We don't have any mathematics or everything. So since we are a bit late on time, I will start. This is a joint effort, as Professor Manolis told you, with Dr. Papanikolaou. About two, 3 years ago, first of all, our institute is ITSAC. We are now merged with the Earthquake Planning and Protection Organization. We are one of the institutes, of the public institutes, with, I dare say, with lots of experience on instrumentation of structures and health monitoring issues in Greece. During the previous degree seminar here in Thessaloniki, I presented also some of our activities. You can find it on the internet, those of you who didn't attend this meeting. About two, 3 years ago, when Dr. Papanikolaou was just a new PhD, he had finished, he had graduated from his PhD studies. During a visit to our institute, he saw our laboratory. He was excited because apart from his numerous, very impressive experience and say feats on civil engineering things, he told me that he was a keen he was keen in electronics. And during our conversation, we ended up in setting up this a research grant proposal for building a MEMS accelerometer. We got the grant, and we got mainly thanks to the great talents of Dr. Papanikolaou. I dare say quite satisfactory results from, as we are going to see. So what triggered our first motivation is that, as you all know, due to various geological and geophysical conditions and due to local topography, the ground motion of an earthquake shows significant variations both in PGAs and frequency content, even within small distances. So this is particularly important in urban areas because, as you know, the usual national codes prescribe a single design PGA for an area larger than an urban area. It's much larger for a certain region of the country. So in case of critical structures, or if we want to design with more detail, we have to have something more than the code prescribed PGA value to design our structure. So we have to know the distribution of the PGAs in a certain area. This is something that the microzonation studies try to tackle. This is a problem that the microzonation studies try to tackle. We all know that we have somewhere in the depth of the sea, of the soil, the source of the earthquake. We don't have any idea of the record here. This vibration disperses through the bedrock, the stiff soil, the rock, the engineering, let's say, or seismological bedrock. There's a difference between them, but let's say this is very stiff soil. And after that, after reaching this limit, which is defined through a value of Vs of the shear waves, it goes then up to different locations through softer layers, which usually amplify the signal. This amplification can also vary depending, apart from the soil layers, on the local topography of a region. For example, in convex sites, such as the top of the hills, there is usually more amplification of the seismic signal, while in convex areas, like the bottom of a hill or on the valleys, this amplification is lower. There are various reasons for this, but the problem of the engineer is that usually due to the expensive equipment, due to the expensive accelerometers that we can have in our disposal, we usually have, for example, in this area, only one instrument installed in this area, let's say here. So what we record on the surface is, let's say, this waveform. In order to be able to compute the other areas, we have to find a way from this point to go down to the bedrock, go to the area where we want to estimate the new waveform of the earthquake, and then go up. In order to do it, people who know about the macroresonation studies know that there are lots and lots of physical and analytical uncertainties involved. It is very difficult to know the profile of the soil. It is very difficult to estimate the topography, the local topography. So there are many factors which make the prediction of the PGA, not even the waveform, even to predict correctly the PGA in various areas of the region under study based on one set of recording involves very uncertainties, and it has to be validated with the experimental data. So an ideal approach, not alternative I dare say, but a complementary, would be to be able to have the whole area covered with a dense grid of accelerometers, and then just have already ready the waveforms at each site, and then through these waveforms and the GIS system to be able to create the PGA distribution values in the area under approach, under study. But the problem with this until now was the prohibited cost of the equipment, which usually the commercial equipment available until a few years ago was in the order of 3,000 to 4,000 euros. These that are used for seismological observations. So, for our needs as an engineer, we don't need the accuracy, the high accuracy of this expensive equipment. And our idea is to build a MEM-based sensor that Dr. Papanikolaou will be able to describe to you in detail later, who will be able to give us a certain, who will be able to accurately report vibrations after a second, let's say, an engineering values of 20 or 30 milliGs, 2 or 3% of Gs, above which these excitations are interesting for engineering purposes. The advantage of this equipment is its low cost, and these are the various components that Dr. Papanikolaou will explain to you later. Together with this accelerograph, there has been a whole suite of software that was developed during the project to communicate with the instruments, to manipulate the recordings, and to create hazard maps. They will be shown by Dr. Papanikolaou. And this is the setup that was used in our laboratory to, after the design, the construction, and the assembly of this low-cost accelerograph, which we name Seismovac. This is a group. This is a typical accelerometer used in strong motion network works throughout the globe. It costs about 3,500 to 4,000 euros. Extremely high accuracy. And this is a setup here. This is a shaker that we used to calibrate and to validate the results of our design. And here's a comparison. You may not see any difference. This is an arbitrary shaking that we did at the laboratory with various frequencies and spikes and everything. And it's quite big, it's about 30 seconds. And you can see that there's a green line and there's a blue, a red line. The red line is our equipment whose components cost less than 100 euros, and the green one is the one of the high accuracy equipment. And this is a zoom of the previous slide, so you can see that this is both in time domain and in frequency domain. So they are what we think are very satisfactory results compared to the accurate instrument. So after testing these components, Dr. Papanikolaou hand assembled 20 plus, almost 30 of this seismopack accelerometers. There is I don't know if you will mention, but you can find on YouTube, he also patented some things to assemble this. You can find on YouTube his presentations. And after producing this equipment, we had to choose a certain area in Greece to make a pilot application. This was done in the summer of 2013. This is the seismic hazard map of Greece. There are three areas depending on the seismicity. And of course the most earthquake prone one is here is the Ionian Islands with a higher seismicity. Of this area we choose one island, the Northern Island, the northern island, the island of Lefkas. The whole island is called Lefkas, and here is the capital of the island, the main city of the island, which is also called Lefkas. So we went to the town of Lefkas over there to set up our network. We chose it because, as I said, it was in the highest seismicity zone. In 2003, near this island, there was an earthquake of 6.4 magnitude. We already knew that in the area of the town there was a high variability of soil conditions, but with very soft deposits in several parts of the city. And the 2003 earthquake gave us a visual example of this variability. After that, we also had several projects already running in the island. That means these are practical issues when we try to choose an area. We knew the people, we knew the soil conditions. We had the connections necessary to make our life easier. And also, this island is a very easy one to access. So I'm going to give you, knowing that, as I told you, it's a hot summer afternoon here, a little tourist, let's say, information about the island. Here's the island. And this is the northern part. This is the town of Lefkas. This is the mainland. But you can visit the island through this road. So it's technically an island, but you don't need a boat to go there. And these are shallow waters, but this is the main waterway to go to the island, to the town. So over here is the point of connection between the mainland and the way to go to the island. This is the same from the north. This is the way we go to this. And you can see the topography. So we have here a valley with soft deposits here. And over here, there is rock formations, so there is a variability of the soil conditions in this area, which makes it suitable for instrumentation to be able to evaluate the difference of soil conditions in the recordings. And just for, let's say, tourists, this is how you go there. This is a bridge, but it's not technically a bridge, it's a kind of ferry, which is here, it is a pin, a vertical pin. And when boats want to go, this whole structure rotates. From one part it opens, and then after that it goes back to this position, and it bridges the road to the island. Some more pictures of the city. And during the 2003 earthquake, which happened here, 6.14, this is the, there were some of the reporters that we had at that time. This is the one that already existed as a part of the strong motion network of that we keep. We have about 240 accelerometers throughout Greece, which form half of the part of the national accelerometer array in Greece. And this is, there were some, after the earthquake, we installed some additional accelerometers. And these are, this is the part of the city and the points of where several damages occurred. And there were very extensive geotechnical type failures along this coast, as we were going to see. And this is the kind of damage that was observed. The retaining walls translated and rotated and failed due to the insufficiently condensed consolidated soils behind them. These are also some, let's say, typical damage along the coast that I told that I, the seaside, the sea walk that I showed you before. And this is a typical liquefaction phenomenon that you already know from theoretical point of view, but it was observed in several parts of the island. This kind of typical when water goes up and the soil is liquefied. So we have soft deposits and characteristic, let's say, not exactly failure, but not so easy to find in earthquakes. Is there were two buildings here. There were statically independent buildings. This one, both of them subsided. You see here the subsidence of the buildings due to the soft soil due to the earthquake. But they subsided uniformly and not differentially, so there was not actual any damage to the structural bearing system. But the funny thing that the subsidence of the two buildings was not the equal. One of them subsided, this one being heavier, subsided more than this one. And here in the first floor, both of the buildings served as the same restaurant. So the restaurant extended in both buildings, and we were able to see here the difference in the subsidence between these two buildings, because there were tubes in the restaurant for water that broke and were later restored. So we see that between these two buildings there was a differential subsidence of 6 to 7 centimeters, and this was also confirmed by another fact that in one of the buildings, this is the same kind of separation of the buildings. In one of the buildings was this table, and there was a door on the other part of the building, which when the buildings were at the same height, this door hit this table and left this mark. So this one was over here. So after the earthquake, we also see that the differential subsidence was of the order of 6 to 7 centimeters between the two buildings. If you go there, there's a friendly restaurant, it still works. You go to the Google Maps and you can see it standing there 12 years and there's no problem. Anyway, all this made this area, the selection of this area, quite interesting. And we had 21 devices installed in the both in the center, which is the most this a historical center with a dense population and buildings, and throughout the broad area of the island. I remind you that here begins the mountains, the hills, let's say, and while this area is typically a valley. And this is the grid of the sensors that we used. To give you an idea of the dimension, this is a 4.5 by 2 kilometer grid for these sensors, for these 21 sensors. And if we zoom in this area, this is typically a 1 by 1 kilometer area where 12 sensors were installed, and especially of these 9 sensors were installed in an approximately 500 times 500 area, one quarter of a square kilometer, so it's very dense grid. It would not be feasibly, economically feasible to do this with equipment that costs 4,000 euros it's for each one, but we could afford it. One of the things that we wanted to during the installation was preferably to have our sensors installed in areas where there was no interaction with the building. Typically, many sensors are installed in the basements of buildings because they for safety reasons, for internet communications, for power supply reasons. But this interaction of the building response with the sensor alters the vibrations. So we wanted to have locations where the installation would be as free-field as possible, and we chose these pillars, these boxes, where these are used to distribute electricity in the lights, the road lights of the island, so they have continuous power supply. And this is one of our installations, so it's typically not affected by any building response, except of the adjacent ones, but we cannot avoid it being an urban area. And in cases that we were not able to install it in the box, we installed it with watertight junction boxes at the base of these pillars. Of course, some of the areas we couldn't find any of this, and we had to install them at the basement or at the ground floor of buildings, but it was about 20% of the whole grid. So these are the very easy to install, very typical tools, nothing dramatic to do the installation. And after that we had to wait, and we were lucky. Because with these things we have to depend on Mother Nature. 6 months after the installation, and after having some time about adjusting the triggering levels of the sensors, but this is something that we can discuss later if there's time. There has been an earthquake of 6.1 in a nearby island of Cefalonia, about 70 kilometers to the south of our site, and we were able to. And this earthquake triggered 18 out of the 21 of our devices. So it was a good, it was a very fortunate event, in that we were able to test the ability of our network, the lowest ability of our network to trigger. So it was something that it was a very happy excitation level, just to the thresholds, and it gave us also the idea how down to which level our devices can trigger and record an earthquake. So from the records and using the software suits that Vasilis has developed, from the raw records, we did the bulk filtering assessment of the records and got the post-processed results. And these results were introduced into also custom software for creating PGA distribution maps. And here are the results. And here we see the distribution of the PGA, the north-south, in the north-south direction of the area. So you can see that it's nothing but a single PGA value as prescribed by the codes. We got here PGAs varying from 21 to 70 millijith, and I remind you this is a 4 by 2 kilometer area. So we have a high variation. This is also a zoom in the, let's say, 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer area of the main urban area. So we have distinct, very distinct zones of different PGA values. And the same idea we get the same we have for the east-west component. The PGA is varying from 19 to 77 millijith, and also this is a zone of the urban area, which, as I remind you, was the area which was also greatly hit by the 2003 and the earthquake, and this is the main urban area of the Lefkasta. So the up-down components were not so differentiated and were not so great due to the distance of the source of the earthquake from the recording site. Apart from that, in the city of Lefkas, there were installed by our institute two high-precision instruments. One was a typical instrument already existing for the strong motion network that we run in Greece, as I told you, this instrument. And the second one, during our effort and in collaboration with a seismologist of our institute, Dr. Tavoulidis, we installed one extra high-precision instrument outside here in a pillar. The instrument is here, this is the pillar. This is the building, this is a building which houses the other record, the other sensor. There is a 70 meters distance between these two. And next to the two high precision instruments, we also installed our two far sensors. And by the way, as I told you, there were other projects in this building. We also have this building instrumented for seismic monitoring, health monitoring issue. That is not our subject, but it was something that helped us already know the people there and helped us in choosing Lefkada for our site. And here is the comparison between within the building, between the, for the earthquake of that we recorded, between the Bural and our instruments. You can see that there is a satisfactory agreement in time history and also in Fourier domain. And similar results for the free field instrument, both in time history and in time domain, in Fourier domain. So we were happy with the results. It was a great job done by Vasilis. I was just there to set up the questions and the challenges, and he had to work them out, and he did them in the best way possible, I'm sure. So what we plan to do in the future, God helping and finance existing, is to elaborate our software more and make comparison with our other instruments. But as I told you, we are happy with our results. We still have this network in Lefkas, and we have to go there, and we try to maintain it with minimal resources, expecting new strong events. And also, we, as Vasilis will show you, he already began designing a new version, version 2 of the instrument, more compact. So I hope I didn't tire you too much. Thank you for your attention, and Vasilis will go on with showing the details of the vessel. Thank you.